Hi, this is Misha, and in today's video we're taking a look at a pretty rare and unique rifle. This is a Spanish manufactured, MARS imported CETME Sporter. Now about 4 years ago we did a video on one of these, but it wasn't this exact one. The one in that video was in mint condition, unfired. I ended up moving it along when an offer came along, This one here is was someone's shooter, which is fine. So it's got some wear to it, which is why I've kind of played with it some, done some modifications. But just got through putting the first rounds through it today that we've ever done, and it functioned flawlessly, and it was very pleasant to shoot. The CETME is it's getting more attention these days. People are starting to understand what it was. But for a long time, people felt it was a copy of the G3, which is couldn't be further from the truth. Really, its roots can be traced back to World War II. There was the STG-44, originally the MP-43, which was commonly acknowledged as the first assault rifle. It fired 7.92 by 33 Kurtz, which was an intermediate cartridge. Mauser developed the STG-45M in the early part of 1945, and it was one of the first guns to not use a gas system. It used a roller delay blowback, which was taken from the MG-42, but the MG-42 did have a gas system. The roller blowback system was just there to lock the breech temporarily. Well, the STG-45 relied upon only the rollers to lock the gun up to cycle. It as well fired the 7.92 Kurtz, but it didn't go into production, and they only made a few prototypes, and then I think about enough parts were made to produce about 150-200 of the STG-45M. Well, the main designer, Mr. Vor Grimler at Mauser, fled to Spain. Well, actually he went to France, then to Spain. And in 1949, the Spanish government set up CETME, which basically stood for the Center for Technical Developments and so on and so forth. It was there to basically make new guns. The Spanish government wanted a new assault rifle, battle rifle to replace its aging fleet of a lot of different Mausers. They had the 1893, they had the 1916, they had the M43, and so on and so forth. Well, when Vor Grimler went to Spain, he went to work for CETME, and he took his knowledge of the STG-45M and its roller-delayed blowback system there. And by 1952, they started to have some prototypes. Now, the earliest cartridge that Spain was interested in was the 7.92 Kurtz. But soon, they wanted a little more range, a little more power. They went to 7.92 by 40 millimeter CETME. Well, this was turned into 7.62 by 40 CETME around 1953, 1954. And then in 1956, they released the Modello A, chambered for 7.62 by 51 CETME. This was 1956. That was the immediate forerunner of the CETME battle rifle that Spain would adopt. The Model A was quite a bit different, and it could only handle the 7.62 CETME, which was dimensionally the same as 7.62 NATO, but lower power. And they were using this because in full automatic, as most of you know, anything in 7.62 NATO is pretty darn controllable. So they went with that. The Model B came out in 1957, and then in 1958, the Spanish military tried it out and adopted it. And it fired 7.62 CETME. It also fired, with having the bolt head and some parts changed out, 7.62 NATO. So the Model B was strong enough to fire 7.62 NATO, although in the beginning it was still chambered for 7.62 CETME. We're flashing up pictures, I hope, of these different models, so you see what I'm talking about. The Model B actually was kind of interesting. It used a Mauser-style rear sight. It had the safety on the right side of the lower frame, and it used a metal handguard with a folding bipod. It was standard issue in Spain for a while, but in 1964, the Spanish military decided it wanted to conform with the rest of NATO, so it adopted the CETME Model C, which is what we're getting to in my hands here. The Model C was like the B, except it would go to the modern features, such as the wood handguard. It would do away with the folding bipod and go to a clip-on bipod that would attach to the barrel, kind of like a M16A1 style. They would move the safety to the left side over here. And we would go to this paddle wheel style rear sight. And it would fire 7.62 NATO, and they would get away from that reduced power CETME cartridge, just to conform with the rest of NATO. Now, the Model C would remain standard issue in Spain until being replaced officially in 1999 by the HK-G36. But it took time to phase them out of service, with the last ones really not going out of service until well into the 21st century. Now, to backtrack a bit and where the connection with HK lies, in 1958, West Germany was holding trials to select a new rifle to replace the FN-FAL, which they called the G1, and they were testing out a version of the Model B, and they accepted it into service as the G3, which HK would produce under license in West Germany, along with Rheinmetall. So there were two companies producing what was essentially a modified version of the CETME, known as the G3. So the early G3s look a lot like CETME Model Bs and early CETME Model Cs. They'll have wood furniture, so on and so forth. So that's where the connection lies. As you know, HK took the roller lock system and ran with it, making the huge family. You know, you've got the HK-33 and 5.56, 223. You've got the MP5 series, MP5K, and 9mm. You've got several machine guns, and so on and so forth. They ran with it, but that's for another day. So, what about this gun we have out here today, the MARS CETME? In 1964, the company of CETME wanted to get in on the American sporting market. They partnered with a company called MARS out of Chicago, Illinois, to import a semi-automatic-only version of their rifle. And it's interesting, the early prototypes were still much like the Model B. But since the Model C was coming into service at the exact same time, the actual import versions that started to come in 1965 were like this, the Model C style, with the paddle rear sight and all that. Now, the earliest imports did have the Model B style metal handguard with bipod, but everything else about them was Model C. They would begin to import these in 1965, as I said. And between that time and 1971, they would import 1,254, give or take a couple. Not a very large number. These were extremely expensive. I've read one source that claims in modern dollars it would have been about $1,600 to $1,800 to buy one. Mags were very expensive at about $40 a pop in modern dollars. So they were expensive, kind of sporty guns. And when they came in, they had a sporter-style butt plate that said CETME on it. They did not have the bayonet lug. And they had this Weaver-style scope mount base on top as opposed to the claw type. Now, to make it semi-auto legal to satisfy the ATF, this does have a push pin lower. But instead of being up here, they had to move it back here. So there's a little shelf. And they also had to put this divot in the trigger frame here so a full auto trigger pack could not be dropped in. That's what they had to do. What's nice about this one, since it's not a collector grade, it's a shooter grade one, I felt perfectly free to militarize it a bit and make it into a really close Model C copy clone. I put in a bayonet lug out of a Spanish armorer's kit. It's got the cleaning kit behind it here. Have a military wooden handguard. I put a military buttstock on it with the correct military butt plate. The reason I did that is with the Sporter butt plate, it's too long for me. It adds at least an inch to this, and it's just, it's incredibly long for what it is, and I find that uncomfortable. Got the original style sling on it. It has a similar hook to an HK up front. An easily adjustable buckle here. This is a very flexible, soft, but thick nylon material, so it's quite comfortable, even by modern standards. We've got a leather piece here, and it comes through the stock, much like a Mauser would. It's fastened with a Mauser-style clip, keeper, I call it. And it has two holes to store your takedown pins in. It takes down just like a G3 would. Internally, it is extremely similar to a G3. The buffer is a little bit heavier, so it does have a little bit less felt recoil than some G3s out there. Anyway, I stumbled across this. A friend had picked it up and needed cash in a hurry to pick up something else, so I grabbed it off of him, figuring it'd be fun, and I'd show you guys, and hope you enjoyed looking at it. It's definitely not something you see every day. It is a pleasure to shoot. These actually have very nice triggers. I'm sure that's one thing that CETME did, was to tune the trigger a bit. The safety moves in the correct direction, as most Americans would think of it. Down is fire, up is safe. When it's in safe mode, you cannot charge the action. It does have a metal cocking handle, so it should. But once it's cocked, you can rack the action with the safety on. It takes standard CETME magazines, the curved steel kind. It does not, unfortunately, have the paddle mag release. So you have to use the terribly unergonomic button here, which you cannot reach, or if you can, finger exercises. In the video, you also saw me firing a Century C308 and firing my trusty Greek SAR-3, and I just brought those out today to shoot against this, just to see how the felt recoil was, how the handling was, and they're all superb guns. I really enjoy shooting these any chance I can get. But yeah, the Mars imported CETME Sporter. Definitely something you don't see every day. If you ever run across these are extremely high quality. You notice there's not a lot of weld here to be seen up front where the receiver is welded. It's virtually impossible to even tell. It's very even where the cocking tube is welded. It's kind of difficult to tell. They put a lot of effort into making these look very attractive. I've even read that they x-rayed these to make sure there weren't any imperfections in the metal. So the CETME company really tried to impress the American market with their craftsmanship, and I think they did a superb job. I mean, these came in at the same time as the Santa Fe HK-41s, and are every bit the same quality. Yeah, like I said, this one was someone's shooter, so it's got some wear back here in other places. It was a little dirty inside when I got it, but that's all right. It still shoots well, and that doesn't mean I don't have to worry about putting scratches and scuffs and wear and tear on a mint example. Also, you saw in the video, I was using one of the mag loaders that came in the CETME armorers kit that Apex is carrying. I ordered one from them. They got it here in a hurry. It's a really cool kit. It came with several 20-round mags, a 5-round mag, that loader you saw. It came with this buttstock here, this handguard, and another two. I think it was two handguards. It came with this pistol grip. And another couple. The CETME grip that comes on it from the factory, from the Mars, I have the original furniture. But it's a real glossed up, shiny one. And I just like this kind of matte. It doesn't slide. It doesn't show scratches. So I'm keeping the original furniture, which is very pretty, up safe and sound. So, but yeah, the armor's kit was really neat. It had all the small spare parts. It had a whole rack of tools, including mallets and pliers and spare slings and spare cleaning kit gear. He even had a bunch of string to make spare cleaning ropes. So if you've got a CETME, it's a really cool accessory to have. There's not enough parts there to build a gun, like, from a parts kit. It doesn't have things like the cocking tube or the barrel, obviously. It does have a complete spare bolt group, though. Flash hiders and bayonet lugs. That's where I got this lug from, too. Anyway, just thought we'd share something that was kind of unique and cool, I thought. If you have any questions, please post them below. We really appreciate you tuning in, and if you like the video, please click the button. And tune in next time for hopefully more interesting videos.